Hello and welcome to the inaugural episode of Kill All Squares, a World Pop Cinema podcast. I'm your host, intergalactic fuckboy Generalissimo Fortissimo, joined in the broadcast booth today by...
Kai.
And we are christening this already sinking ship with Seijun Suzuki's 1967 magnum opus, Branded to Kill. Starring the man with the bulletproof cheekbones, Joe Shishido, Branded to Kill has influenced artists from Tarantino to Jim Jarmusch to Suda51, as well as influencing the Japanese film industry of the day to blackball Suzuki from making films in the country for about 10 years. Quick synopsis courtesy of IMDb. After a badly done assignment, a hitman finds himself in conflict with his organization, and one mysterious and dangerous fellow hitman in particular. So, without further ado, I open the floor to my colleague to ask, how did we feel about this one?
Surprisingly, very good. I didn't tell you this before we watched the film. I think I mentioned it, like, halfway through. I am not a fan of, like, any of the many subgenres that this film covers. But somehow I just... really loved this. It was very charming.
Right, the operative subgenres, I think, being gangster film and softcore porn.
Yeah.
I guess art house, but that's kind of a nebulous genre, and I wouldn't call this strictly art house because it's actually fun to watch. Extremely, you know, usually on lists of, if you like weird movies, you might like this one, and at least you won't forget watching it either way. Shown this to one other person before you, and I showed it to my little brother, who we will inevitably have on a podcast episode sometime from now, and I think this is the movie that started the trend of every single time I showed my little brother something, he resented me on kind of like a fundamental level for it. He does not tend to like the movies I show him, even a little bit. This kind of being the archetypal example of what I would like to show him, what I'd like to show my friends in general, which is weird, artsy, but also, like, fun genre bullshit. And this is definitely kind of exhibit A for that. Very dynamic, very... calling a movie cinematic seems like the dumbest possible thing to say, but yeah. You know it when you see it. Very... very appreciably gorgeous use of black and white cinematography, extremely engaging everything else, courtesy of it being weird and not giving a shit that you think it's weird. And just in general, a movie where there's always something interesting happening on screen, which it's, you know, not to sound too much like an accelerationist or anything, but it's not always easy to say that about genre films from 50 plus years ago. You kind of have to gear into them, and I think this movie is basically like as manic as a modern action movie in a lot of ways, and quite a lot nicer to look at. Not just because there are, you know, nearly naked or naked Japanese babes throughout the entire runtime of the movie, which both of us
I was about to say, really cute ones, I might add.
Oh, yeah. There was a bit... You, on the phone when we were watching this, there's a bit where the assassin in of the title... Well, not of the title. Well, I guess he is Branded to Kill, but he's not... His name is not Branded to Kill. First name Branded, last name to Kill. He's hanging out with his lady friend, and they've... I believe this is after they've fucked, because a fundamental plot point of this movie is that the assassin in question... cannot get it up unless he smells boiling rice, which is the plot point I always describe to someone to show them that if they like that plot point and think it sounds like a really cool idea, or at least like something they would want to see out of curiosity, they might like the movie. Generally, people get repelled enough by that they realize that is the precise moment that they realize they shouldn't watch it. So it's a good kind of litmus test for people when I talk about this movie. And there's a sequence where she's just kind of freaking out to the camera. A lot of sequences like that in this movie. And you, over the phone, I remember you saying, wow, she's so cute.
She is.
In the middle of what kind of looked like a drug freak out. Oh God, that's my Pepsi. This movie is just, it's manic, it's crazy. It's gorgeous in more ways than just that, but of course, you know, it's important too. to the point where I, even for 1960s Japanese movies, which were renowned for looking like way, way better than they should, to the point where like weird, dumb tokusatsu films from the 60s still look like they were made by like fucking one of those like German directors that came to America to make film noir. Yeah, this movie still holds, still stands out. The sort of painterly focus of this film, and it's an amazing irony that Seijun Suzuki very famously, the reason this film was in black and white after a few years of him doing color films for Nikkatsu, Japan's oldest film studio, which by the end of the decade had transitioned to mostly porn, and entirely porn by the 80s, I believe. They took away his color film because they thought, after the previous movie he made, Tokyo Drifter, not to be confused with the Fast and Furious movie, though that might be what it takes its name from, that if they took away his color film, he would make less strange movies, because they thought the movies drew their weirdness from his use of very hallucinogenic, sort of swinging London-ish, sort of fancy, almost neon and giant primary color palette. That did not turn out to be the case, and I would argue that one of the reasons it didn't turn out to be the case was because Seijun Suzuki essentially made this movie as weird as possible out of spite. A really fundamental part of this movie, necessary to understanding why it is the way it is that much of the movie was written between Seijun Suzuki and his drinking buddies at the bar he would go to after work. He would go in and essentially, like, this was a democratically written film. They'd all get kind of drunk, and some of them probably very drunk because most of them were college kids. And he'd be like, "Hey, what does everybody think should happen next?" And someone would chime in with something, and he'd bring, I assume, his big ass typewriter in there. He seems like the kind to do that. And he'd type some stuff up. He'd write down what he thought should happen next. And this movie was essentially, usually when you think of a movie written by committee, you think of stodgy and starchy, Marvel movies where, anything kind of too creative and the director probably gets sacked. No, this movie being written by committee made it about a million times weirder than it ever would have been otherwise. Pretty much out of
Which is a
spite.
great motivator,
And,
honestly. I aspire to make art
oh
based
yeah,
on
oh
spite.
yeah. To make art based on spite that then becomes like seminal gangster movie material. I guess we can run over some more specific highlights, though kind of inevitably with a movie like Branded to Kill, the story is really a series of and then and then and thens. I guess the first thing we got to talk about, the first like iconic scene in this, the first one that I heard you get an actual like audible like over the top reaction from is the
Well,
faucet
no, before
scene.
that though, the scene where with the lighter.
Oh yeah. The so there's a sequence, the first like really big action sequence in the movie. There's a preliminary one to kind of grease the wheels and to establish a twist later on in the movie that's really not much of a twist. Basically, I'll tell this to you even having sight unseen. The chicken shit character from the very beginning of the movie is the final boss of the movie all along. And the movie presents that like as a really dynamic and terrifying twist, but the rest of the movie is so crazy, you've probably forgotten to even think about this movie in terms of plot. So that opening action scene, pretty fun, but relatively low key compared to the second big series of action set pieces where Goro, the Yakuza's number three killer, because I guess they have a scoreboard for that kind of thing, is given an assignment to kill three different people. I believe later on it's revealed that they're part of a diamond smuggling operation. And he kills one of the first, his first hit is by pointing a sniper rifle through one of those. You know how in 1950s California they had all of those like really crazy buildings with like gigantic marquee signs, like a donut shop would have a giant donut. Literally, like the roof would be molded into the shape of a giant donut. Like, if any of you have seen Dope, that donut shop in Inglewood, that's sort of those kitschy 1950s buildings, most of which don't exist anymore. Well, this was an ad sign for a cigar lighter that had a moving cigar lighter that would pop open. And Goro points a sniper rifle through the cigar lighter right as we realize for the first time that this thing moves, and he snipes the guy through it. And I remember hearing either an audible gasp or an audible holy shit from you
I
when that
think both.
happened.
Yeah, that was incredible.
Then, yeah. And it's probably, I don't assume they built that for that scene because 1960s Tokyo was such like, it was in such a golden age of kitsch at the time. I really would not be surprised if they didn't have to construct that. Also, the movie was made for a pretty low budget. Even a movie like this that would splurge on insane bullshit, would probably not be able to do that. But yeah, like they just kind of, it's one of those like you're driving down the street, you see that, and you're like, and he hmmed well enough that he made something really, really crazy cool, and that's the first like first of many really awesome like screen cap this and show it to your friends moments. Very show it to your friends kind of movie. Then, not a few minutes later, he has to kill a guy with a glass eye who's at the optometrist, the very rude optometrist, who just like smacks his glass eye back inside his head. And this is like a really you popped for this super hard. In a scene that will be familiar to any of you if you've seen Jim Jarmusch's film Ghost Dog Way of the Samurai, Goro kills this guy by waiting until he leans over the sink, pointing his pistol through the bottom of the pipe from underneath, from underground, and shooting through the faucet. The bullet then travels up through the sink and th right through the guy's head. Water pressure and physics in general be damned, leaving an exit wound larger than the entry wound. It is amazing.
Yeah, that one got another audible gasp from me.
It was so cool seeing someone see this for the first time. I've watched this movie about a half dozen times since high school. Seijun Suzuki, one of my major influences growing up, which I think says all that needs to be said about both me as a person, or a kind of duffel bag full of hamsters pretending to be a person, and my taste. Then, of course, he makes his escape, killing the final person. I believe he kills the optometrist. And then kills the patient in the same room by making his getaway floating on a giant hot air balloon and shooting through the window. We don't see how he gets off the hot air balloon, if I remember correctly.
No, I don't think we do. It just cuts to another scene.
Yup. We see the hot air balloon well into the air. I believe it's a hot air balloon that advertises cigars, so there's kind of a nice, there's kind of a nice, like, holistic coming full circle in this movie, as if this movie really needed to have consistent or circuitous meaning to it. But yeah, that's really the that's I think people watch that sequence and then immediately they realize, oh yeah, this is a film. This movie is special in exactly the way that people think of when they think cult movie. This movie is. Aside from that, what are some other set pieces that you remember from this movie from that really, really stuck out to you your
So I
first time
mentioned the
watching it?
staircase in his apartment, which he precariously has sex on with like this poor woman's head hanging over the railing. That kind of freaked me out a little bit. But I thought like the whole apartment design just in general was really cool.
Like the most iconically 60s building in the world. Looks like something James Bond would fucking wind up in. And just, yeah, the one of the first of many sex scenes in this movie. Really not surprising that Nakatsu eventually became a porn studio. Though they make like legitimate movies again now. Not that porn isn't legitimate, but a very different kind of legitimate. And there's a scene where they have sex over the spiral staircase. And both you and I, me having seen this movie before, are like, don't fall, don't fall, don't fall, don't fall. How are you going to explain this to the insurance broker for the movie if you fall?
Yeah, I would be freaked out if I was
Oh,
if I was the
God.
actress. Like, major props to her.
Yep, she was his girlfriend. Or his. Yeah, his girlfriend, I think, Mommy. She did like a crazy tour de force, just absolutely insane performance in this movie. The whole cast is just madcap and manic, and they know what kind of movie they're in. Which you say that about a lot of like so bad it's good movies. You rarely say that about a movie that's entire existence is a little bit unprecedented. I don't know how they realized or how Suzuki realized how to get the kind of reaction out of them that he needed to, but they really do act in a way that sort of the very uniquely like almost Lynchian histrionics of over the top acting and sort of fake and deliberately phony melodrama that just complements the atmosphere of the movie so well and makes it so much more ridiculous. And his girlfriend Mommy, I do not have the cast in front of me. She did an absolutely bang up job and is kind of the honestly, she's kind of a gatekeeper for the weird of this movie because her, Joe Shishido is kind of downplayed. His performance is kind of low key until the sort of final act where the sort of final big set piece comes in. So you don't realize Mariko Ogawa. Oh my God, that is her. She's been in plenty of movies, I think. I think she's actually like, no, she's not. Oh, a different Ogawa. I'm sorry.
It's okay. I had to do the same thing. So, funny enough, I was watching a movie oh, a while back. It was this terrible horror movie, and it said it was directed by Paul Verhoeven, and I did a double take. There are apparently multiple Paul Verhoevens. Like, not just two, but like a bunch.
Jesus Christ.
So, that.
I mean, I guess Verhoeven is like a pretty common Dutch surname, but that's
Yeah,
still
well,
kind
the
of
fact that there's
terrifying.
like multiple of them that are all filmmakers, though, is just kind of amusing to me.
That's really creepy. And in, I assume, Holland, which doesn't have a lot of film production. I mean, the joke is that the most prominent recent Dutch director made The Human Centipede, which A isn't a Dutch movie and B isn't much of something to be proud of. But anyway, so yeah, there's this the performances in this movie are that kind of sort of uncanny valley melodrama that I think really just tremendously works, and it's the kind of thing that I can't imagine you knew was going to work until the movie's done. In particular, the sort of the most incredible performance in this movie that just basically like sells this movie as sort of a dreamlike cult classic of a, of a of an experience basically, is sort of after it gives me a way to segue into plot. After that whole collection of set pieces, he meets Misako, played by Anumari, who is a well, how to describe her? She really likes
Yeah,
butterflies
she wants to die.
and dead birds. One of her first full her fir I believe one of her very first complete sentences is, "My dream is to die." Incidentally, when I saw this movie a few years ago, I texted this I texted that screen I texted that entire conversation that she has with Goro in the car, because he meets her in a car and it's like pouring rain outside, and she talks of and they're both kind of talking in a very maudlin way, and she says that her dream is to die. And I texted the entire and I screen capped the a few screenshots from that conversation and then sent it to my significant other with the caption, "Me and Bae." Very, very strange, enigmatic character, sort of performed by Anumari like a force of nature. I described her as looking like one of those 1970s like Japanese folk rock album covers by people like Haruomi Hosono that have become pretty popular on YouTube, because everything Japanese eventually becomes popular with a certain niche on YouTube. And like they all have these like very long-haired, black-haired Japanese women with like stern expressions on their faces. She's kind of like the platonic ideal of that. Kind of reminds me of someone like Meiko Kaji or Reiko Ikei, the sort of pinky violence actresses of the 70s. And she is just the most like terrifyingly enigmatic character in this entire film. Really kind of, to me, more interesting than the guy with chipmunk cheeks in the lead.
Yeah, I would have to agree with that. Although, I don't know. They were all pretty interesting. I mean, if a guy's thing is that he has to smell rice to get it up, like that's memorable.
Yeah, and played by a guy who absolutely. And the interesting subtext that Joe Shishido was maybe a weirder, maybe not a weirder dude, but he was weird in his own way IRL too, because obviously like everyone comments on his chipmunk cheeks and people think, "Oh, was that like a birth thing? Was that, you know, just a byproduct of some kind of condition?" No, that was a cosmetic surgery he had on purpose to sort of make him look more distinct because he thought, you know, he didn't want to just You know, he wasn't enough of a pretty boy to get all the pretty boy roles in Japan at the time. Kind of roles that would go to a guy like Ken Takakura. He didn't have that look. He didn't really have that presence. So he went for something a little more rugged, which was really uncommon and still somewhat uncommon among mainstream Japanese actors. And it really made him look very captivatingly rugged after a fashion. I think we're seeing him very shortly after he even had that surgery, maybe like a few years. Later in life, it kind of he kind of grows into it, and he actually does look very, very charming with them. But here, there's this uncanny valley. He looks essentially like he's been stuffed with formaldehyde and is somehow still alive, you know, which very, very strange. But of course, I sound something like a broken record because strange is really the adjective you can come back to with this movie. That and depending on your taste, brilliant.
Right. I would add memorable. I mean, good Lord. Like, I'm not gonna forget this anytime
Memorable,
soon.
yeah. For a movie that doesn't have much in the way of plot, that doesn't have much in the way of like forward action, that's like deliberate forward action where you know where the movie's going to go, it is imminently memorable. Last time I saw this movie must have been more than 5 years ago. It had to have been. And I remembered almost every set piece in this, even the ones that weren't, you know, even the ones that weren't necessarily iconic. There's a very good one towards the end where he's met the number one killer, which allows me to segue into that plot point. The number three killer in Japan wants to become, of course, the number one killer. If any of you have played No More Heroes, I don't believe Suda 51 has ever mentioned this movie as an influence, at least not directly. I would have to look it up. It is very obvious to me that if great minds think alike, great minds think very, very alike, because No More Heroes is all about that as a plot point, sort of character who's deliberately written as kind of a tool, trying to become the number one assassin in the world because the assassins, for some reason, spend more time killing each other than they do killing their targets. When the number three, Goro, meets the number one assassin. He has a shootout in it along a dock, and the way that he covers himself is by tying a rope to the front of this car and getting underneath it and towing the car forward as he crawls across the ground and shooting people from the undercarriage of this car, which is such a clever thing to do. Also really hilarious because that's kind of how car scenes are usually done in Hollywood movies with a tow truck. So it's a nice little meta joke there if you've worked on movies or know people who have worked on movies, and a very cool sort of creative addition to what in a lot of its contemporaries would have probably just been a standard stand out in the open and shoot the bad guys shootout scene. Not a lot of wasted action in terms of creativity here. And then when he meets the number one and the number one, of course, apprehends him, then the movie gets even weirder. Kyla, would you like to describe some of what happens at
Oh
that
my
act in the
gosh.
movie?
So basically, the number one guy is trying to just wear him down. So he just our protagonist is able to retreat back to his house and barricades himself inside, and he keeps getting phone calls. And this guy's like, "Oh, make sure to eat. Make sure you're getting enough rest," which obviously he's not, 'cause he knows this guy is gonna come kill him eventually.
This also happening after the number one has had a full opportunity to just shoot this guy in the face. We know he's quicker on the draw than number three, but he decides instead to turn this into a giant psychological game.
So eventually, I don't remember how this happens. They end up as roommates, for lack of a better word, or just sharing the same living space and devising all these ways to constantly keep an eye on each other which are really ridiculous. So, like, at one point, the number one killer just straight up pisses himself, which is kind of amusing
And lets it
because
drain
then
out of his, and lets it drain
yeah,
out of
and then
his
the other guy
shoe.
just laughs at him and
Which is like the closest to a realistic reaction Goro has in the entire film. The one time he's acting like a normal human being, and it's like it's sort of a pull back the curtain moment where even the movie acknowledges that that's kind of
Right.
fucked up,
Yeah,
which
no,
is
that was really
great.
amusing.
It's a joke that you've got to. Yeah, that entire sequence is something else. There's a sequence where to try and keep himself awake, Goro looks like he's hanging himself, but he's actually hanging himself by the chin so his head doesn't move down so he can't fall asleep. It honestly kind of reminds me of if any of you have seen Nightmare 2, when the guy cuts his own eyelids off to keep himself staying awake. It's kind of what that reminds me of.
You had mentioned when we were watching it,
I think it was
you were
Nightmare
like,
2.
man, if like the last 20 minutes or so had been their own movie, that would have been a completely different kind of movie.
And it would have kicked ass, but I'm glad that we had all of the carnival stuff beforehand, because otherwise it's sort of a taut thriller, and there are plenty of taut thrillers. Taut thrillers that include deliberately improbable physics, weird sex, and boiling rice. Yeah, there's pretty much one movie that does that. And so yeah, I guess we've done kind of the main bullet points of this joint. We could be here for longer than the runtime of the movie, just running down every single iconically strange part of this thing. But hopefully, the 1.5 people who are probably going to be watching this first episode, we've whetted your appetite. We've made you interested in something to that you might not have watched otherwise, which is sort of the ultimate goal of this film. That and to torment my friends. Kyla, do you have anything you'd like to plug?
Sure, I can go ahead and plug my podcast. So, I host a podcast called Netflix and Kill, where myself and my co-hosts go through Netflix and pick out horror movies. Most of them pretty bad, but there are a few gems in there too. Actually, Aaron has been a guest on our podcast on multiple occasions, mostly to talk about Hellraiser, so definitely go listen to those episodes. I guess also, I don't know if it's like weird to plug the movie we just watched, but seriously, if you're listening to this and it sounds like it's your thing, it's on the Criterion channel. I got like a free 14-day trial so I could watch this movie. So, which like that in and of itself is a topic, the Criterion channel, because like what
Oh,
a
yeah.
random collection of movies you would never guess. Like if I had watched this on its own, I never would have guessed that this was in the Criterion collection. I mean,
Oh,
along
no
with like
shit.
Sallow, right? Like there are some movies that kind of
Oh,
just
yeah.
make me tilt my head a little bit.
Yep. And I guess they're kind of doing the same thing that I try to do with this, which is get people engaged without making them feel like they're going to school again. And we hope we haven't made you feel that way, if nothing else. We hope this wasn't like pulling teeth, and that if it was like pulling teeth, well, we hope you're into that. I guess we'll just I guess I'll just say, be nice to your parents, enjoy rice, and we'll see you next time. And in the words of Duke Ellington, we do love you madly.